again, everyone. This is the Black Knight, and I have returned to the Senora Freeway here. The Senora Freeway race simply to pay homage. That's right, to pay homage to the Grand Tour, the first episode of the Grand Tour, the return of Clarkson, Hammond, and May. No, that's not a law office. If you don't know what I'm talking about, then perhaps this isn't the video for you. To do this, what we are doing is we are picking cars from the game, which owe their likeness and somewhat their performance to cars from the real world, which were, of course, featured in the first episode of the Grand Tour. We're bringing the ProGen T20, which is very much like the McLaren P1, except it's like the McLaren P1 if the McLaren P1 were seeing a really good psychiatrist. There's a lot more control to this car than what is at least exhibited when you watch it on television. I've never been behind the wheel, so I can't really speak to it. Anyone wants to give me the keys, I'm more than willing to try that out. That'd be fantastic. Might be the last thing I do, but it'd be fantastic to try that out. We're bringing the Pfister 811, which is very much like the Porsche 918, if the Porsche 918 had been drinking heavily lately because of some personal problems. It's all over the road. Now, the LaFerrari poses kind of a problem in that there's a couple cars in-game that owe their likenesses and some of their characteristics to the LaFerrari. We're talking about the Turismo R and the Osiris. We're gonna run them both because I don't know which one is more LaFerrari-like. I don't think either of them really matches the LaFerrari and what the performance should be, but this is a video game, so they have to balance things and things like that. I think whatever LaFerrari they put into the game should really probably drive more like the RE7B, which I'm also bringing an RE7B because whenever you do a comparison like this, you say, hey, look, here we have these cars and there's a theme. There's going to be somebody commenting, well, why didn't you drive the RE7B? It's the fastest car in the game. So we're going to do that to keep those people happy. And then to keep the motorcycle people happy, we will also bring out again the Hakuchou Drag and the Shotaro, just to say, yes, here are the times for the Hakuchou Drag and the Shotaro. And, you know, there is some pertinence there to the conversation. So we'll bring those along. And I've also brought out my own personal heavily modified Sentinel XS, simply because it so closely resembles the M2 that Jeremy featured in the show. And by being closely resembles, I mean it's the wrong color, it's heavily modified, there's wings on it and stuff, but at least it has that kind of Beamer vibe. Not to get too spoilery, but I'm not going to tell you what happens in the show, or who wins or what, but they do pick up immediately and try to close the loop on something that had been a question from the old Top Gear. And that was, what's faster, the P1 or the 918? And at the time, I believe the bet was that if the 918 was faster, Clarkson would have to change his name to Jennifer. Because that's a Top Gear thing, they seem to have let that completely slide here. Although they did come up with another bet, which is probably better. Not gonna reveal anything. Watch the show, it was awesome. I watched it twice. Trust me, you have to see this. One of the points that was made, though, is that because they're using the same tires for all three cars, and because they're using the same driver for all three cars, a Belgian Formula One driver, and because they're using the same track, therefore any differences in the times would have to be limited to the differences in the cars, and I'm not sure that's true. When you have three cars like this that have such amazing performance, we're talking nearly 1,000 horsepower in all the cars, that have such different handling characteristics, they have such different profiles to them, if all of the cars will exceed the performance of the track, if you can drive faster with these cars than is physically possible on the track, if you can push these tires harder with these cars than is possible, if you can slide these cars off the road and these tires cannot keep up with the cars, if the cars can go faster than is humanly possible to control them, if you get to the point where it's really the cars themselves exceed everything, then what you'll get is you'll get all the cars, if you have a really good consistent driver, all the cars will end up with nearly the same time going around the track. Again, I'm not going to say exactly what goes on here, but I will say that I think that they might have to consider this. If you get the same times on all the cars, roughly, not saying exactly what happened here, I think that you might need a bigger track. You might need, you know, either that or a windier track, or it's actually gonna vary per car which track it likes. I mean, if you have a car that handles extremely well, For instance, say like the 918, if it outhandles the other cars, then a twisty track, it's gonna do better. If you have a car that has a higher top end, that can go faster, that it can accelerate faster to that top end, then if you have a better power to weight ratio, then a longer track with longer straights, where it can use more of its top speed, is going to benefit that car, and that car is going to look faster. And so, in this case, I don't know that you could even call a fastest car with one of these three cars. It's going to depend on, again, on which car suits your style. If I had millions of dollars just, you know, sitting in the bank burning a hole, I, you know, couldn't find anything good to do with it, I'd have to take each of these cars out if I was going to buy one and then see which one fit my style. And that's the one you buy, because, you know, you're personally going to go faster with that car than you would in one of the other cars, even if one of the other cars is quote unquote better. And, you know, with the same driver, same tire, same track, if you max out the numbers, then I don't know. I don't know if you've truly found the best car. I don't know if you can find the best car. The track that might truly test these cars may not exist, because, you know, the cars are going to be driven by a human being, and the tires are going to be, you know, made of rubber. They're not made of, you know, magicness. And so that's an interesting problem. It's an interesting problem. How do you test a car that is that fast and that powerful and that incredible? Have we come to the point where there's no point in improving them, because we really can't drive them any faster than we drive them? The perfect example of that in this game is the Shotaro and the Hakuchou Drag. These are two very different bikes with very different handling characteristics, very, you know, different top speeds, but they compensate for different things. They're very closely balanced to each other. They turn very similar times. There's definitely a different feel to them. It's much harder driving the Hakuchou Drag very fast, although if you're good at it, I mean, it has much better brakes, it has much better acceleration. The Shotaro will take the corners far better. It's far more, you don't have to think about taking the corners in the Shotaro. I would say the Shotaro is easier to drive, at least for me personally. But then again, that could be a style thing, you know? It's an interesting point. But here are two bikes where if you have a race between the two of them on any given day, either one of them is going to win. You know, you'd have to, you know, once you get really, if you have someone who's really good at a specific bike, gets really used to it, then it comes down to a matter of driver skill, I think, as far as these two bikes are concerned. Which one's better? I honestly couldn't call that. That's going to be a tough call. And I think that's what is happening in this first edition of the Grand Tour. You have three cars here where I think it's very difficult to call out what car is the best. Now, I will say this. I don't think it would matter in the outcome of the bet for various reasons. And so the bet's going to go on. But then I can't wait to see that episode. That'll be great. Maybe there'll be clemency. Let's put it that way. Maybe there'll be kindness offered here, and we'll let everybody slide, and we'll see how that goes. I don't know. You don't see a lot of that on this show. So I would, though, highly recommend get out there. If you have Amazon Prime, check it out. I'm sure there'll be clips of it all over YouTube at some point, if they're not there already. But that's just the nature of YouTube. Stuff gets on the internet. And they've got to be at least doing promotions for it. You got to see some of the clips. But I would definitely recommend, if you've got it, watch it. I mean, I watched it twice. I might watch it again today. It is just fabulous. Guys, welcome back. Clarkson, Hammond, and May, it's so good having you back on some kind of screen where we can watch you do crazy things like this. And very enjoyable. Very happy to see the new driver. Again, I won't want to reveal anything here. Not the shtig, but I think he's gonna be a huge asset to the team. Again, I won't reveal anything. Don't want to give away any revelations here. We'll probably talk about him in a future video. But very happy to see him there. I've actually been a fan of his for a long time. I always thought he was a really cool driver. And this looks like it's gonna be fun. Also, my deepest condolences to the families of all the celebrities killed during the filming of the show. That was kind of a spoiler, but kind of not. You have to watch it to see what goes on. That's just, oh God. I can't wait to see if that's gonna be a weekly thing. That could be interesting. We gotta see how that works out.
Now, let's get back into the more traditional
gameplay voiceover kind of thing, the whole hardcore gamer mindset. Here we are following the Osiris as I took this through the turns. Here's a real critical turn coming up. This makes or breaks right here, this 90 degree turn. And not too bad. Kicked it around a little bit. You know, there's always these little kind of things where if you take the turn perfectly or not perfectly, that's what changes the lap times. As you see, I put the lap times up before, just at the beginning for the people who have, like, no patience or anything, but, where are the lap times? But we'll put them up here again. Right there. We'll put the lap times up. And, as you can see, this Osiris did almost as well as the T20. I mean, they're neck and neck. And so if you really want either car, if you have to pick between one or the other, you're good. You're good either way on those, I think, no matter what's going on. Generally speaking, the T20 is considered the standard for racing in this game. If it's either faster than the T20 or slower than the T20 as far as anything that you measure. And pretty much if you bring a T20 up to a race, you're going to be competitive. That's not to say that if you meet somebody with an RE7B that's comparably equipped, that you're not going to have a little bit more difficulty with them. And that's going to come down to if they match your skill, the RE7B is going to have an advantage. There's no question about that. One of the things that surprised me was the Turismo R. I thought that was going to do a lot better than it did, because that lap, it pulled a 210, which is not a bad lap, but it's nowhere near the T20's 202, and there wasn't anything on that lap that I said, gee, this is going to make it a slow lap. I mean, I don't think I made any huge mistakes running that. So I would have figured it would have been at least in the 206, 208 range. But 210, that's actually slower than my fully modified Sentinel XS, which pulled in, you know, a little bit better than the 210, the 209.06. 209.601, actually. And, which is kind of a surprise, but I mean, there is some overlap between, you know, the different classes, and the coupe class has some quick stuff in it. Again, that was really, again, just part of the theme here, the whole Top Gear theme. But I was impressed that the Sentinel XS actually did better than the Turismo R. Now, that wasn't a fully modified Turismo R by any stretch of the imagination, so I have a feeling, mod that one out, it's going to blow the doors off of the Sentinel. But probably by, I'm guessing by 2 seconds. Usually, I found that once the mods kick in, you get about 3 seconds on this particular course. So therefore, you're looking at a 207. But even so, a 207 on the Turismo R isn't as good as the 811 in stock form. And it's certainly not up to the T20 or the Osiris in stock form. But pretty much write the Turismo R off, because that's less than what for style. If you want to cruise around it, it's beautiful, wonderful. Not a bad car to drive at all. But for whatever reason, unless that was just there's something anomalous in that lap that I did wrong, we'll do more investigations into that at a later date, see what's up with the Turismo R. Then you can talk about a little bit more about the bikes. I mean, the bikes are basically within 0.4 of a second of each other. That's human error at that point. That means they're basically just as fast. But it is fascinating, as we hear right now, we're watching the RE7B just take the corners flat out. When I was driving that thing, it was just, you didn't have to slow down for most of the corner. Unless it was a 90 degree corner, you didn't have to slow down. It just takes them, it just handles them. It's just a wonderful car to drive. Not as fast as it was when it was glitched and was doing ridiculous amounts of speed, and there are all kinds of ways of making it do different things there. The whole use your stock tires and your stock suspension and bump it off things and blah, blah, blah. But it is still that is definitely the fastest car I've seen it going. It's just really quick. But, now we're going to get into the bike races. No, here we have the Sentinel XS. Now here you can see, it's just so beamery. Let's watch this beamer run here. You got the carbon hood going. We've got black paint with red pearlescent over it. There's your tow hook. This thing's loaded for bear. It's got the carbon wing on it. Custom plates. Red tire smoke as we blast along here into the tunnel. And it's an interesting thing. This is not considered one of the... Well, it's one of the fastest of the coupes for racing. Per Brophy 1322, who is the standard bearer for racing testing and consistent laps around his short track. He's got a really tight track that he uses. The Zion is definitely the fastest as far as he is concerned. I definitely had a little too much confidence in the car going into that turn. Which, again, tells you again, there's at least a second loss there that blew the window out of it. And it still beat the Turismo R. So I still have to go back and try to figure out what's up with the Turismo R. That's just, you know. So here we are. At least you can see, you know, more of the interior. As you can see, we've got the whole, you know, racing frame in the car, the chassis upgrade. And we're sliding. I'm pushing it as hard as I can here. Just trying to do Jeremy proud. Speed! Push this Beamer around here. Interesting thing, it's where, you know, this feels really good to me, this car. The Zion is supposed to be faster. I'm not sure if the regular Sentinel is faster on certain courses. You know, it feels a little more stable, the regular Sentinel. But it's not supposed to, it's not as nimble as this car. So I think probably the XS loaded out is probably better than your Sentinel loaded out. But it's going to depend on what you like again. Then you got the Felon. You throw the Felon in there. The Felon is great unless you accidentally hit a curb with it, in which case it's rolling. It's a little bit light, and things happen with the Felon. But, you know, the Felon's, I've got one of each. And I'm always in the corner is which one I like better. You know, the Felon, the Zion, or one of the Sentinels. Those are the, it's when you're driving coupes, that's really where you're at. And here we come up, now we come up on the end of the whole run here. I was thinking, perhaps, of just overlapping all of the races one on top of another so you can see them all happen. I don't know if there's too many races, it might be just a jumble of pixels there, you know, that's... You could do that with one or two cars, maybe three cars. You start doing a whole bunch of them, then it's gonna be hard to see what's going on. So now... We have, I believe, the Hakuchou Drag is the first one that came up. And these are fully modded. These are my own personal ones. You know, but I bought that Hakuchou Drag, you know, when it was on sale. Now it's back to being a $1 million bike. And it's an interesting thing. It's got some interesting handling qualities. It's sometimes that rear end kicks around on me. It just surprised me. It doesn't seem to slide. It just seems like they've got the point of rotation is in the wrong place or something like that graphically. It just seems like it throws the rear end out a little bit more than you think. What it really looks like is it looks like they took the actual Hakuchou bike, put the big rear end on it, and didn't change anything else except the actual stats. Wow, the brakes. It brakes so hard, you can just go full speed until you absolutely have to turn. But it takes a lot of concentration. You have to lean forward to get the most speed out of it. And here we go around the bend. I'm concentrating. I'm not even playing it right now. I'm actually watching the video. It takes so much concentration because you don't want to lose it. And I'm using a keyboard, so it's tap, tap, tap. It's not an analog kind of feedback sort of thing. And so it's a lot of concentration. Going tippity-tappity on the A and D keys here. And we're coming up on the big 90-degree turn here. I think I might have actually overbraked this. No, that's about, yeah, I slowed down more than I had to, but it slows down so quickly, it throws you off. And then, but accelerates just as quickly, so you recover. Probably if you could really get riding this bike down, I mean, you'd probably be unstoppable. It's like the Dominator muscle car. If you're good at it, you know, if you can master the Dominator, you will dominate. But it has a tendency, there are certain times it'll bite you. You know, the Dominator especially will come around. This bike's not as bad. But to really wring the most out of it, I mean, you can have a comfortable run on this bike, no problem, but if you really want to really use the latest braking point you can, and then the most acceleration, crank as much top speed of it, leaning forward, but don't, you know, be leaning forward when you hit the brakes, or you do an endo and flip the thing or whatever. That's it takes a lot of work, but it's a fast bike. I mean, 151, 601, that's really, that's a good clip. And we level up. That's just great. 215. Yeah, and I'm the winner because I'm racing by myself. Wearing that Nagasaki t-shirt because this is my new favorite bike. This is the one I'm cruising with now. Originally, my favorite bike was the original Hakuchou because it's so wheelieable. And I still really love that bike. You could just wheelie and stunt around that. You just hold a wheelie right into a concrete, you know, concrete divider, and it bounces you up in the air, and you fly along, and it's like hitting a ramp. It's just wonderful. But this, man, I'm leaning forward, although they say it really doesn't matter. I'm just trying to be consistent. It does the same speed whether you're leaning forward or not leaning forward. It's great with that. So you can really, this is a bike you can one-hand race, no problem. And it's just really quick. Watch this turn. Now, it doesn't brake as well as the other bike. It doesn't seem to need to, though. This is, you know, this is the Tron bike. It seems to have a tremendous amount of grip, and that's just where you can really do a lot of stuff. Again, this felt like the RE7B. I'm flat out. I don't have to think about it. Just make the turns. Unless you're turning 90 degrees, unless you're making a right, or hanging a Louie, as they would say, you just keep it wide open. The one thing probably keeping your head down does is it doesn't jump as much on the little crests and hills and stuff like that, so that you keep in contact with the road, keep a little more control. How did I do on the big turn? This is the one that you can really screw up and lose a lot of time on. That's not too bad. After this, it's pretty much flat out up until you get up to the last 90. Flat out around the bends here. And braking turn, there you go. Wow. Just through that turn so quickly. And that's really this bike's advantage. It can just go. The fun part about this, take it through traffic. When you're in free mode and you're just driving this bike through traffic, it seems like it's infinitely narrow. It just zip right through stuff. You know, if the free mode challenge comes up that says, hey, you know, near misses, see how many near misses you can get? This is the one you want to be driving. This is the one as far as that's concerned, because you're just, it's so precise for some reason. I don't know if it's a slightly slower steering rate, if it just has more grip and there's no push. What makes it so wonderful, I don't know, but I love driving that bike. It's easy. And it looks fantastic. I mean, it's a Tron bike. It looks much better at night with everything lit up. I have it in my Steelers livery there, that's, you know, with the little Ukuk symbol on the side there for the base motorcycle club Ukuk. There's a long story there, we explain that another time. Has nothing to do with Harambe though, just let's be clear on that. Now here we have, we've done racing, we're driving back, and we're in the Dubs to 6x6, which if you want to just get a side shot of the Dubs to 6x6, the Dubs to 6x6, you definitely want to have somebody else driving while you're taking that shot, otherwise you'll drive right into a concrete wall like I just did. And this truck's strength is, of course, as far as practicality, it's extremely capable off-road. And you're going to see me flip it over a couple times here. Very tough. It is not a racing truck. This is not one you're going to want to take into an off-road official race against people. Not just for that reason, but it's just not as fast as some of the other cars. I mean, it's not as fast as either of the professional racing trucks they've got in the game, you know. It's not going to be nearly as fast as the BF400. I mean, it's just, you're not going to get that kind of one. It's probably halfway down the list as far as off-road racing. Which is kind of odd because you have to be level 100 to buy it. And it's extremely expensive. I forget what it was, a third of a million, half a million, something like that. But I only bought it for one reason, and for one reason only, and we're back to Top Gear again. Richard Hammond drove this very truck, the real-life equivalent of it, in Dubai, I believe it was. He drove it across the deserts, and that was one of the best sequences I've ever seen. And I love Top Gear, but I loved that particular sequence with that truck. It was just fantastic. It was funny. It was impressive. I mean, the truck itself was really impressive. And it makes you want one. And I would actually think, based on how much horsepower the real truck has, that if this one had that much horsepower, it would do better than it does. I think it would actually be a good bit quicker than it is. In-game, it might actually be a legitimate racing threat. But I got this, I leveled myself to 100 primarily to get this truck. And here we are in front of the desert artwork here for the people who are waiting for the aliens to come back and take them someplace. And
that's what we have going on there.
On that note, this is The Black Knight. Have a great night.